Welcome to the session, and I hope you all had a great conference today. I'm Vivek Chanddru, working for Zoho Corporation as a mobile app lead and Android developer. I'm basically from India, and I'm going to talk about how you can teach Kotlin to play well with Java. You all know that Kotlin has a great interoperability support with Java, and it works great out of the box. But there are a few things that you might want to know so that you can make the lives of Java developers who use your Kotlin methods and of classes easier. So that is what I'm going to talk about. But before we start, how many of you already know Kotlin and are actively working on it? That's great. So how many of you are working with Java developers on the same project or creating libraries that is going to be used by Java developers? Awesome. So you people can find out much about how Kotlin can work well with Java with a few annotations and a few tips that you can do. So I'm a Kotlin enthusiast. I have been working on Kotlin right before Google announced it as a first-class citizen for Android development. And I'm here not because I'm a Kotlin enthusiast, but because I am rooting for Java developers who are facing some sort of criticism because Kotlin is great and Java is not that great. So why is there so much hype? We all know that Kotlin was announced early in February 2016, and Google announced it as a first-class citizen for Android development in 2017. And then we all got to know what Kotlin is, that it is a much better Java, and it has got a lot of language features that is there in a lot of modern languages. So it's all great, and it is a boon for Java programmers who are stuck with verbose code, and it's great. Riam is one company that had a survey on the Kotlin adoption in 2017, and I shamelessly ripped it off their site because I'm not that creative to create a graph or a chart. So before Google I/O, less than 10% of Android developers were using Kotlin, and this survey was conducted in September 2017, and around 20% of Android developers moved to Kotlin. That's great, but we are here now. So that is my creativity over there. I had that bar. We are here, and approximately 50% of Android developers would be using Kotlin by now. So this is a great time where you have to like think about the other half, or even the worst half, if you can say. So Kotlin adoption is going great, and very soon Kotlin is going to overtake Java as the default language for Android development, and there are a lot of new libraries popping up with Kotlin support, and existing libraries are providing support for Kotlin and Kotlin language features, and all the sample apps, codes, and Medium articles are filled with Kotlin. You don't see any Java code in the Medium articles, in the Stack Overflow links anymore, unless it is specifically related to Java. So when it comes to Android development, all the people who are in the field are already talking about Kotlin than Java. So Kotlin is going great, and people are adopting it. So why should I care about Java developers? They are going to anyway move over to Kotlin in the future time. So why should we care about them? Everyone has their own problems, and some has to learn an all-new language. Most of the people who work in Android development actually had their roots in server development. So they came from a Java background, and it was pretty much easier for them to get into Android development, but now they have to learn an all-new language. So even if you are willing to learn a new language, it is not very easy to convince your team to move to a new language. So also your company might not be willing to spend some time and the resources required to move to a new language. So, and you probably won't be wanting to break something that is already working fine. So the Java code is working fine, it is compiling, its performance is great, so why do you have to move to Kotlin when it is already working? And I'm not sure about the US, but there are still a few countries where it is very difficult to find Kotlin developers who are expert in their field, and there are a lot of Java developers over there, so it's kind of hard to get some Kotlin experts. And I'm really sorry to have the points come one by one, because I thought it would be so much fun, but I now understand that it's going to take a lot of time. So coming to the point, most of it is not their fault, and they are willing to learn Kotlin, they are willing to migrate to Kotlin, but it's not that easy for them, and they don't have the time and resources to migrate to Kotlin. So fear of missing out. So what goes in the Java developer's mind? Everyone is in the Kotlin bandwagon, and they are not able to get into it. So Java developers feel left out. So a new blog, it's in Kotlin. A library, it's in Kotlin. And there are a lot of Kotlin-only libraries that are coming up because they have a great language support, and it is not very easy to backport it to Java. So the developers just assume, OK, let people use this library if they want Kotlin. Or if they want this library, let them use Kotlin. So that's the kind of mindset that developers are going on about. And they are left with the mercy of default implementation where which Kotlin provides for interoperability with Java. So what you can do is what this talk is going to be on. So this is the introduction. And what Kotlin does is pretty much known to everybody. So it provides you ways where you can use Java code directly from Kotlin and Kotlin code directly from Java. So it's not magic. So you probably have to do certain things to your code, very small things that can make a huge impact on the Java developers who consume your code. So this talk is aimed on people who are working on Kotlin with a team of Java developers, or developing Kotlin libraries which they intend the Java developers to use. So coming to the tips, I'm going to talk about 11, and this is the first of it. Think about the access scopes. So we all know that Java has its own private, public, protected, and default, and Kotlin has the same private, public, protected, and internal. So how does it play well together? Because there is no default here, and there is no internal here. So that's going to cause some confusions. Privates stay private. Private in Kotlin is going to be private in Java, so it's not going to be accessible. Private top-level functions. So Kotlin has a great feature where you don't need to declare a class. You can just directly open up a Kotlin.kt file, and you can just give your own methods in there, and it would work seamlessly from Kotlin. But in Java, it might not work as you wish. But if you declare a private method in without a class, it's going to be a package local. So it's going to be accessible in all the Java classes in the same package. And protected members in Java are not really protected, because it can be accessed by the same class or its derived class and by the classes in the same package. So in Kotlin, it is accessible only by the class and its derived class. So if you declare a protected member or a function inside the Kotlin, it's not going to be available only for the same class and the derived class. It's going to be available for some other classes too. So you might want to like consider those things. And internal members becomes public after some name mangling, they call it. So they just rename the method so that it's very hard to find. So internal methods, internal members is a feature where you can declare a field or a function as internal to the module alone. So when you do that, it's not going to be visible only to the module, it's going to be visible across, but the names are going to be changed so that it's kind of hard for the consumers to know, but it is there. So you might want to like have a look at it, and public says public. So the second thing that I would like to talk about is regarding the top level functions. As I said earlier, you have to like consider this code where we have an amazing utils with a function age which always returns 42, and when you use it from Kotlin, it's great. You can just say calculate age and it's going to work fine. But when you use it from Java, if you can see this, amazing utils kt.calculate age. So what does it mean? JVM, Kotlin compiler, works together to create a new class called as amazing utils kt, because there is no class where you declared this thing. So it's going to create a new class, and magically, this KT happens. So it could have been amazing utils, but no. Kotlin developers just thought that, OK, let's add KT to the end, and say that this has been developed in a Kotlin class. So you can hide that if you want. You just have to say at file JVM name and give it some name. So at the top of your Kotlin file, you just do this annotation. You can just say the Kotlin and JVM compiler that this file is going to be called as utils or something else, and any method inside it can be used directly using that class name. So it's not amazing utils KT anymore. It's going to be the name that you give. So you have the control, and you don't have to like expose the language that you're using inside your class, inside your code, or inside your library. You can just have it the way that you want it. And let's assume that you've got multiple util files, because that's what we always do: string utils, test utils, network utils, device utils, so on and so forth. So let's assume that you have got two util files, a.kt and b.kt, and you want all the methods in both the util files to be under the same file for the Java consumer, to be under the same class, to be exact. So you can just say at file JVM name, and at file JVM name, and give it the same name. But you have to say JVM multifile class so that the JVM and Kotlin compiler knows that all the methods inside these util files should go inside a single class called as utils. So when you do that, both the functions, though they are from a.kt and b.kt, are accessible under the same file. So this change is not going to make a huge difference for you, and it's not a breaking change, or without this, it's not going to break for Java developers. They just have to say akt.calculateAge and bkt.isEligibleToAuth. So that's fine for them. If it's fine for you, then fine. But if you want to provide some extra boost to the Java developers and make your code like readable and something, this is probably one of the things that you might want to look at. And just because we changed the name of the class, we would want to change the name of the function too. So that's sort of common and that's sort of human. So you can do that. Let's assume this unique extension function that I came up with. I hope no one came up with this. So this function is going to check whether a string is an empty or not. So that's pretty complex. And in Kotlin, you can simply say the string variable dot is null or empty, and it's going to work great. So it's sort of like the method got itself into the Android SDK and works the magic. But in Java, the extension functions are going to be compiled as a static method. So you just have to say the class name where it is where the function is declared, and probably say the class name dot is null or empty, and pass in the string. So this is great, but unless you check the type of the parameter, you would not know what is null or empty is. Does it check for a string? Does it check for a list? You probably wouldn't know unless you check the parameters that the method is getting. So you probably want to like rename this method so that the consumer, the Java consumer who is calling the function, can have some context to this. So how do we do that? The same JVM name comes here. So you just say JVM name and give it a name. So when you do that, the Kotlin part remains the same. It doesn't get affected, and you still call it with the string variable dot is null or empty. It's not going to change. But this line is going to tell the JVM that there is a new method called is string null or empty, because that's what we said there. And this gives some context to the Java consumer, because utils.isNullOrEmpty with a string parameter is not great, when utils.isStringNullOrEmpty gives much more context. So this is not the best name that I could come up with. So if you can rename it to something much more flexible and giving more context, that would be great. So this is fine, but let's look at this code. We have got an extension function, filter valid, on a list of integer and a list of string. So this looks great. So it's just going to take in a function and just filter it and return a list. So this should compile, right? Is there any issue with this? Yes, there is. So what happens is, it the both of these functions take in a list of something and returns list. So the JVM complains that filter valid is taking a list and returning a list, and there is a signature clash there. So you probably would be like using a generic here, but for some reason, if you're going to use something like this with the same name and hoping that it would work, it would not, even for the Kotlin. So even if you don't consider a Java developer who is working with you, this won't compile even if you are just targeting Kotlin audience. So you have to change one of the names. So you have to say filter valid string, at least one of them. So you can even say filter valid int if you want. But once you do this, the Kotlin and JVM works together, and you can still use filter valid in Kotlin. So you can still use a list of integer dot filter valid, it's going to work. A list of string dot filter valid, it's going to work. But in Java, it's going to say filter valid and filter valid string. So the JVM doesn't have a signature clash anymore, and the Kotlin is already happy with the list of string and list of int, so it's going to work for both Kotlin and Java. But this is one thing that you have to do even if you don't support Java developers. So now we change the name of the class and name of the function. So what next? Name of the getters and setters that we have. So we have this great class, person with name and age, because that is all we want from the person class, because we don't collect any other data. So when you declare a class like this, the JVM and Kotlin compiler works together and generates the getters and setters for you. So you don't have to do the heavy lifting, and the Java consumer is going to get name, get age, set name, something like that. So it's pretty great, but what if you want to change the things? What if you want to, like, instead of name, you want to say something else, instead of, okay, let's not look at this code, just look at this one. And if you want to change the name, if you have a custom getter and setter backing fields, you probably want to say at JVM name and change the name of the getter. So here we have not set a custom name for the setter, we have just a custom name for the getter. And if you don't have a custom backing field, custom getters and setters, the accessors, you can probably just say at get colon JVM name, at set colon JVM name. So there are two ways to go about it, and when you do that, this happens. So get name becomes get person name, get age becomes get person age, but since we don't have a setter custom name, we still use set name. So this is pretty basic, but when you consider something like a variable name with underscore or something, let's assume that the variable name is full underscore name. So this might look good on Kotlin where the member is accessed directly, but when the getters and setters get generated, it's probably get full underscore name. It's not going to look that great, but if you can change the name of the getters and setters, it would be pretty much great, yeah? And companions, so the static killer. Let's say that we have an amazing class which has a companion object which does a simple some magic. And we are not going to talk about the magic because we all know what companion object is. It's going to provide some way that you can declare static methods inside the class. When you do this, in the Java, you get stuck with this ugly companion. So this code gets converted into, the companion object gets converted into an inner class that has this method. So Java file does not know that amazing class dot simple util functions would work. So you probably have to use something like this, amazing class dot companion dot simple util function. And most of you know the solution for it. It's JVM static. So this is one of the things that most of you already might have guessed. So when you annotate something with JVM static, it's going to remove that ugly companion, and you can use it in the same way that you would use it from Kotlin. So this is one of the simplest things that I have to do. And let's see. We have seen how we can change the name of the class, function, accessors, and everything. So what if you don't want getters and setters at all? Kotlin doesn't have getters and setters, so Kotlin class can be accessed directly from Kotlin with the member references. They don't have getters and setters. So why do you have to like do getage, setage, and do something like that? Why cannot just go raw and do the things that I want? So that is possible in three cases, where the variable is declared as const. So a constant variable or constant value does not have their own getters and setters. So the getters and setters are not generated by the JVM. And anything that is marked as late in it is can be accessed directly by the member reference. They don't need getters and setters. And if you want any field of your class to be accessed directly instead of having their own getters and setters, you can just mark the field with @JVM field, and it would work out as bots. So coming to the example, you can just say const val, and a normal val is there in a companion. And if you look at it, the const val is getting accessed directly. There is no ugly companion with it. There is no ugly getter with it. It works directly because that's the magic done by const, the constant, and it can be accessed directly. But when you look at the val, it's going to be stuck with amazing class dot companion dot get base underscore URL. So that's not looking good, and you don't want that. You want something like amazing class dot base URL. So that's what we are expecting, but the Java developers are stuck with this kind of thing. And your natural instinct would be to use @JVM static to remove the companion. But when you do that, just the companion gets removed, but you still have to access it like amazing class dot get base URL. So that's not like what you wish for. You just say @JVM field. It is a new another annotation that we are looking at. When you mark a mark a field with an annotation, it's going to remove the ugly companion if it's required, and it's not going to generate the getters and setters. You can access the variable directly. Great. And coming to the late init, we have got a late init variable and a normal variable. So as I said, the late initialized variables can be accessed directly instead of having the need to use the getters and setters. They are there if you want it. So it's not that they are not generated. The getters and setters are already there. But if you want, you can access them directly from Java. And the normal variables cannot be accessed unless they are annotated with JVM field. So as I said, there are three ways to go about it: const, late init, and JVM field. You can choose whichever one you want and do your thing. So default functions. Have any of you used default functions with Java 8? Not Kotlin, Java 8? Yeah. So Kotlin provides a great support for default parameters functions, but they do not work directly with Java. So imagine that you have a function with n number of arguments, and all of them are optional, and all of them have their own default values. It's great in Kotlin. You just say call the method without any parameters, or have a named parameter or something. So it works great from Kotlin, but it does not work at all for Java developers because they do not have the full bandwidth of the Kotlin compiler. So they are stuck with a single method with all the parameters. So they have to call all the parameters even though they have their default parameters. So you can just simply say @JVM overloads, and Kotlin will instruct the JVM that you probably should be generating all the possibilities, all the permutations and combinations of the parameters so that the Java developers can use it as they want. And this JVM overloads is not just for the methods or the functions with default parameters. It's for constructors, static methods, and everything. It works great for everything, except for abstract methods with default parameters and methods in interfaces with default parameters. So you might have to keep that in mind. And a great function here, which increases value by a factor. So pretty hard. I had to like scratch my head to get it. And yeah, so this works great from Java, and this doesn't, because there is no method called increase value with a single parameter. Only increase value with two integers is there for the JVM. So in order to like overcome that, as I said, you just say add JVM overloads, and it works great. So remember that whenever you have a default function and you are like sharing your code with a Java developer or exporting it as a library, you probably want to like have this in mind. And then exceptions, crashes. So Kotlin have great exception handling, just as we all know, but it does not have support for checked exceptions. So what does it mean? So when I say it does not have checked exceptions, Kotlin code when converted to Java code does not have the throw statement in the method signature. So we have if we have a Java method, we would say void, do some file operation, throws IO exception. So that would instruct the consumers of the method that this method is going to throw an IO exception, you better catch it or pass it around so that it can be caught somewhere. But there are no throw statement in Kotlin, and that makes Java consumer grumble. So what you can do is, you can annotate it with @throws instead of just making it throw, and the generated code would have the throw statement. So let me explain this with an example so that it gets better. So we have an exceptional method which throws an exception. And when you do this, this should work, right? This should work because everything is right. We have a method which throws an IO exception, and I'm having a try catch and catching the IO exception, it should work. But what happens is the Java compiler says that this method does not throw an IO exception. So we know that I have explicitly said it to throw an IO exception, but the Java compiler says that this method does not throw any IO exception and you better remove this catch block. So if you remove that, you probably get a runtime exception and your customers complain. So that's fine. And you just mentioned this. So @throws IO exception class. And when you do this, the Java compiler is happy now. So it doesn't care that you caught an IO exception or exception. So it just accepts it and moves on. So when I say that Kotlin does not support checked exceptions, it's for the Kotlin consumption too. So we know that this line is going to throw an exception. When you write to a file, you handle the IO exception. So that's the default thing that we have been taught from the day one of Java, from the day one of Android. So whenever you do something, you catch the exception. But when you have this line of code in Java, it's easier because the compiler or the IDE shows that you have got to like handle this thing, so put it in a try catch block. So Java works well, but this file is in Java, and this is in Kotlin, this is consumed in Kotlin. So what happens is, since Kotlin does not have checked exceptions, it's not going to complain anything, and it's going to let it pass. So when you do this, it allows this line of code. So when you don't handle it here, it should be handled here, but this is not going to be handled anywhere, and it's going to cause a runtime crash for you if there is an exception there. So you have to document the exceptions that you know might arrive with the same @throws exception. So this can be used to say the compiler that this is going to throw an exception, or this can be used to say that I'm using something and this might throw this error, so better handle it. So there are two uses for this, and when you document that exception, the IDE is going to warn you that this is an error and you better have it in try catch block, right? Function types, higher order functions, lambdas, so they are pretty great. We did not have that in Java till Java 8, and then we did not have Android support for Java 8, and then life goes on. So, and then Kotlin came in, and we have got excellent support for higher order functions and lambdas. But one thing is, when you have an higher order function that returns a unit. So we have got a block which returns a unit. So this looks fine for a Kotlin developer because it doesn't matter. You just call Lambda example and pass in a method that's going to work fine. But when you use it from Java, you have to say return unit.instance. And why is that? When we learned Kotlin, intro to Kotlin 101 says that unit is equivalent to Java's void. That's what we all saw, because when people talk about Kotlin, there's no void, there's unit, you can use that. But unit is not void, unit has a value, one, and it's sort of like a singleton, so it has got unit.instance. So you cannot like return void here, so you need to like have this in place, return unit.instance, or if you feel this is unidiomatic, you or probably the Java developer is going to return the return null. So this is sort of unidiomatic. Why do you want to expect people to return something when there is actually nothing returned? We are not returning anything, but we are expecting, when we use it in Kotlin, we are not returning anything, but when we use it from Java, we are expecting them to return something. So it's not that great. What can you do to solve this? You can have a single abstract method interface in Kotlin that says, that does the same thing as the higher order function. It's not an higher order function anymore. It's the same old method that we were using in Java earlier. So we have a single abstract method interface, and then we do this. Java gets cleaner. So this is the best we could do from Java, and with the Lambda Java 8 support, we can get this working. So this is fine in Java. It should work fine in Kotlin, right? Because we have got an interface in Kotlin, the function in Kotlin. It should work fine in Kotlin. But no, it does not work fine in Kotlin because the Lambda support is gone now, and you are probably stuck with this, the old anonymous inner class sort of thing in Java. It's not anymore in Java, it has come to Kotlin right now. So this is not what you expected. You are trying to please the Java developers, and your what you have done is an insult to Kotlin probably. So what you can do is have the interface in Java. So this is the actual magic. What happens is when you have the interface in Java, it's the same thing, and the method in Kotlin, Java remains the same cleaner code, but Kotlin gets a dirty Lambda expression. So it's the same Lambda expression, but it has got some type that you have to mention. So this is fine when you compare to the object callback sort of thing, but why do you want to make it tough for the Kotlin consumers thinking about Java developers? So you can probably ignore all these things and just go with the higher order functions, because Kotlin is already working on this issue, and according to Android developer site, there are two open issues in Kotlin that is going to solve this issue, and you don't have to like work with the interfaces, single abstract method interfaces anymore. But if you want, you can meanwhile, you can use this sort of thing if you really want to please your Java consumers. Coming to this, immutability. Great. So Kotlin by default has the list, map, and set, and every collection as an immutable. So what I mean by immutable is you cannot add anything to the list, you cannot modify the contents of the list, and everything is great, because this is such a great thing that you can be sure that your list is not modified, and you'll know that when your list is modified, it's going to be a copy of it. But when you create a list, an immutable list, and pass it to Java, it's like giving a child an iPhone. So it's going to do something it's not supposed to do. It's going to throw up, and it's going to add something. So this works great for Java, but and it does not it does not crash any issues, but you are under the assumption that this list is not going to be changed at all. And without you knowing it, your consumer has changed the list, and this is going to be causing a problem for you, right? So you have provided a list so to the Java consumer to read it, but they have returned to it, and you don't know. So What you can do is make a defensive copy of it. You can just take a copy of the list that you're going to pass in and just send it in so that your original list remains unchanged. So it's going to take up some memory, but it's the only way that you can be sure of the immutability and invariance. So you have to be sure that the copy that the Java or the consumer gets is not the copy that you originally have, and your original copy is going to remain the same. So that is how you can prevent immutability. And finally, working with coroutines. So coroutines are great, and I'm just going to touch up on this topic because it's such a big topic. So coroutines are lightweight threads, and it's not available in Java, so you can write some coroutines in, Kotlin, and then you can ask your Java consumers to consume it. So you can do that. Let's take a look at this example. So how many of you know Kotlin coroutines? Okay, I've got a few. So what this simply does is, it is going to execute these three lines separately off the main thread, and it's going to return a deferred. So in short, this is a background block. This is going to be executed in the background thread, and for now it's going to be returned, for now it's going to return a deferred. So in Kotlin, this is something async await, and you just call the API method and await for it, and then you call another API method, await for it, and once you get the response for both these things, you're going to combine both the responses and do something. So this is a crude example, and this is not a network call actually. So I'm just simulating it. But deferred is not very easy to use from Java. Deferred is great for Kotlin. You just say, this returns a deferred, and you just say await, it's going to work fine. It's going to wait till the response is returned, and this is returned, and then only you will get this method called, and there is no UI lag. But when you try to do an await from Java for this deferred object, it's going to be a problem, and I was not able to get it to work at all. So what you can do is, Kotlin coroutines provides a great dependency for Java 8 interoperability, and there is something called as future. So Java 8 has completable future support, and there is a async block, just that it is called as future, and that returns a completable future instead of a deferred. So when you do this, your Kotlin part remains the same. It does not change at all. So I just change this future, and then change the completable future, deferred to completable future, and that is pretty much it. So if you want, you can take a look. Async, this one is changed to future, and other than that, the log methods are changed, but that's it. So you just change async with future, and you can use that from your Java code. So the background part is executed separately using the coroutines, but you can consume the result and do whatever that you want using the completable future methods that you have. So it's not as clean as Kotlin does it, because you have to do this then accept and then combine both the results. But it has some callback, but it is better than the list of callbacks that you usually do for the network calls. So that is pretty much it. So if you guys have any questions, you can ask me. Thank you.